are in the preliminary stage of one of the greatest battles in history. I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat.
In the chaos and carnage of total war, high-grade intelligence is as vital as firepower. MI-19, an intelligence department of the British War Office, set out to exploit German prisoners of war in the most ambitious surveillance operation ever attempted. Three stately homes in the British countryside were converted into unlikely prison camps and wired for sound. MI-19's specially designed microphones reached everywhere. Nothing was out of range.
There were bugging devices in the lamp fittings, behind mirrors, in the fireplaces. It was a huge operation and something this technical and sophisticated had never been undertaken before. British were very clever at thinking into the mindset of how they could get intelligence from the enemy. And it was a very British thing to do, actually.
We're very used nowadays to the idea of conversations being bugged. People weren't during the Second World War. This was the beginning of modern surveillance. This was entirely new.
Hidden away in basements and attics were the listening rooms, filled with what at that time was state-of-the-art recording equipment.
I was told to report to the commanding officer that what I was going to do was probably more important for the war effort than if I drove a tank or fired a machine gun.
So, what can you tell me about Nickerbein?
Captured German soldiers were brought to the UK and interrogated. If they were suspected of having important intelligence, the soldiers were then sent to bugged locations, where listeners were ready and waiting for them to start talking.
We were working in a special room which was called the M room. There were five or six of us sitting in front of something like an old-fashioned telephone switchboard. And whenever the conversation seemed to be going towards the subject we were waiting for, we switched on a turntable and recorded on an old-fashioned 78 record what they were saying.
The evidence comes from one of the most audacious operations British intelligence ever conducted. Conversations between German prisoners of war were secretly recorded and then transcribed, word for word.
In the transcripts, we found totally new knowledge about war crimes, about huge war crimes.
I had an hour to spare, and we went to some barracks. And there we slaughtered 1,500 Jews.
These were German soldiers as they'd never been heard before, uncensored and unguarded.
This operation was what was called top secret. I did not tell even my closest family what I had been doing for about 50 years after the war.
Da waren so 20 Schützen da mit Maschinenpistolen. Das machte einen Augenblick, da dachte man gar nichts dabei.
Es tat mir ja wirklich beinahe leid. Ein Volk, was sich selbst nicht aufgibt, kann überhaupt nicht geschlagen.
Using transcripts hidden for decades, these conversations are reconstructed for the first time.
But she let you sleep with her too.
Yes, I mean, you couldn't tell that she was a Jewess. She was quite a nice type too. It was just a shame that she had to die with everybody else. 75,000 Jews were shot there.
Wegen dieser ganzen Morde.
In the aftermath of World War II, ordinary German soldiers claimed they knew nothing about the Holocaust. They blamed all its atrocities on the SS.
Da sind sämtliche Juden hingerichtet worden.
Wir haben so one of these executions once. We were actually there when a pretty girl was shot.
That's too bad.
But she knew she was going to be shot.
But these recently declassified transcripts exposed the full extent of that lie.
do to the children?
They seized three-year-olds by the hair, held them up and shot them with a pistol, threw them in. Just wait for myself.
On the second day of the Polish War, I had to drop bombs on a station at Poznan. Now, 8 out of the 16 bombs
fell on the town among the houses. I didn't like that. But I said to myself, hell, orders are orders.
We knew that the microphones must have been of very high quality because we could hear the prisoners very clearly. And even if they whispered to their cellmate, it was very often possible to pick up what they said.
On the third day, I didn't care. And on the fourth day, I was enjoying it. It was our before breakfast entertainment.
To chase single soldiers across the fields with machine gun fire and leave them lying there with a few bullets in the back.
They weren't being interrogated. They weren't minding what they were saying. They weren't being very careful not to give anything away. They were speaking to their equals in what they thought was privacy.
We attacked civilians in the street, all machine guns firing like mad, and you should have seen the horses stampede.
The recordings were translated into English, and transcripts were sent directly to Churchill himself.
Soldiers across the fields with machine gun fire and leave them lying there with a few bullets in the back.
And soon, they overheard secrets that helped save Britain in its darkest hour. For 8 consecutive months, the German Luftwaffe bombed British cities. 1 million homes were destroyed. In London alone, 40,000 civilians were killed.
The Blitz came as a real shock to Britain and to the people of Britain because it was unrelenting. And what the British really were having difficulty in understanding was how were the Germans managing to guide themselves onto the targets night after night, accurately, in total darkness.
Scientists wondered if the Germans were using a secret navigation system. Their answer came from a conversation between 2 Luftwaffe pilots.
The system is called X-Gerät. I'll tell you how it works. A beam is sent on a short wave. This short wave beam has a width no broader than 1 kilometer,
even as far as London.
This very small snippet of conversation about X-Gerät was hugely significant. And what it was a system of guiding the bombers in using radio pulses, using radio waves. The bombers would effectively fly down the path of a radio wave.
Armed with this top-secret information, scientists jammed the radio navigation beams, saving tens of thousands of lives. They were so successful that some bombers even landed at RAF bases, believing they were back in Germany. But it is only now that we are piecing together the story of this extraordinary bugging operation. And it's only by accident that transcripts were discovered at all. On a routine research trip to the National Archive in London, German historian Sonka Neitzel requested files on U-boat crews. What arrived on his desk was the discovery of a lifetime.
I just ordered 3 files and had these 3 huge, massive files on my desk. And so I start reading that. September 43, German Navy personnel, and it was so authentic. You could really just see the people speaking to each other.
Sonka was given 800 pages of transcripts. The archives contain another 49,000.
And then at that moment, I realized I might be standing on a tip of an iceberg.
The transcribers even noted how the original words were spoken.
Wir fuhren mit dem Motorrad vorbei. Auf einmal ruft sie uns. Sie meinte, sie gehen zum Erschießen.
You were really able to see these people talking. You were able to get a feeling of the killing, the fighting, the dying, the war.
Rechts, links, fertig. Ob sie noch lebten oder nicht, war egal. Sobald die...
When I saw the documents, one of the things that struck me was that how real they were. I mean, the discussions, the way they conducted themselves, this is how soldiers talk.
The recordings reveal shocking secrets about a war where both civilians and soldiers were on the front lines.
Kharkiv was a delightful town. Everybody spoke a little German. They had splendid cinemas, wonderful cafes. It's beautiful country.
Lance Corporal Mueller told Sergeant Faust about his experiences as his unit moved into Russia.
Everywhere we saw women working. Extraordinarily lovely girls. We drove past, we would simply pull them into the armored car, rape them and throw them out again.
And did they curse?
I think these are typical conversations for men at this time. It was totally normal for them, but only for them. For us, it's a very astonishing thing. How can you tell a story about nice Russia as being a tourist and then combining that with a story of raping?
For the first desperate years of war, British intelligence had few prisoners to spy on. But in 1942, Britain's fortunes changed. Victory over the Germans in North Africa brought thousands of POWs to England. Among them, the first senior officers, including the highly prized General Wilhelm Ritter von Thoma. Von Thoma was taken back to London and confined to Trent Park, the stately but bugged home reserved for officers. His capture was a coup. Von Thoma knew the intimate secrets of Hitler's military machine, and though a proud patriot, he was not a member of the Nazi party. He was met by Lord Aberfeldy.
When I was captured, the Italian generals, who were taken at the same time, arrived with a load of luggage. They looked like tourists. I immediately said, please, don't put them with me.
Von Thoma is very intelligent and exceedingly well-read. He has a striking personality and is violently anti-Nazi.
Von Thoma joined General Ludwig Crivelle, who was also captured in North Africa, when his aircraft accidentally landed at a British airfield.
Crivelle is a follower and admirer of Hitler, an ignorant, stupid, sentimental, vain, and self-satisfied type of Prussian senior officer.
Holding such strong, opposing political views, Von Thoma and Crivelle inevitably clashed. And when they did, the recorders were ready.